Hey everyone, I want to thank you all for joining us today for this upcoming conversation with artist Adin Kachisi. I'm extremely excited about this. I'm not going to waste too much time with a preamble. I want to begin by thanking the Harvey B. Gantt Center for consistently putting on these artist talks over the past, what seems like almost 2 years now. It's been really, really fantastic. We've had some great conversations with artists from all over the world. Today, I'm joined by Adin Kachisi. Adin was born in Zimbabwe and currently lives in Harlem, New York City. He holds a master's in urban planning from the University of Hertfordshire in the UK and a graduate diploma in interdisciplinary studies from the University of Western Australia. Kachisi's art is an exploration into the inner world of thought and emotion and the outer world of space and nature. His latest paintings employ a gestural process in which acrylic paint and on canvas is overlaid with thick drop splashes of coffee residue for very liquefied streams of coffee tints. His work was recently on view at Soko Gallery, and his painting Amazon Gentrification is a part of the Harvey B. Gantt Center's permanent collection. So Adin, I want to thank you for joining us today. How are you?
Great, thanks. Thanks, Dex. I want to thank you, Dex, for facilitating this interview, this dialogue. And I want to thank the Harvey B. Gantt Center for not only this event, but all events that they are giving platform to many voices in the artistic community. And I also want to thank the audience who taking their time to be part of this conversation. So I'm excited. Thank you.
Awesome. Awesome. So this is exciting for me for a number of reasons. Mm-hmm. I mean, one is that This is only the second time you and I've had a conversation that was in this sort of format. The exhibition that I mentioned at Soko Gallery took place last April through June of 2021. And it's funny because this pandemic has my internal calendar is just jacked up. Yeah. It's hard for me to remember when things happen because they either seem like they happen much more recently than they happen or much further away than they actually happen. My internal clock is just jacked up. But anyway, if my memory serves me correctly, the exhibition of Soko Gallery was April through June. And it was a group show that included you and three other fantastic artists, Alexis Callender, Signor Reed, and Jackie Malad. And that exhibition had a number of your works in it, and we'll be looking at some of those images as well as some other things that are going on in your studio. But I want to start this conversation with where you are. So you were born in Zimbabwe, but you're not in Zimbabwe right now. So can you tell everyone where you are?
Are you sure this is virtual? Who knows? Yeah, I moved from Zimbabwe many years ago and settled in New York. That's where I live right now. I live in Harlem. So I've been on this pursuit of the creative path for many years. Actually, giving a little bit of background, my interest in art goes back to actually childhood. Just as is the case with many artists, you realize when you're growing up that you can draw. And people tell you, oh, you can draw, you better pursue this. So that's exactly what happened with me. I pursued it and continued drawing, painting, and went through school. Didn't stop. But as you know, sometimes the balance between your identity as an artist versus your responsibility of what you're supposed to be in society, or in other words, a paying career that we can live on, sometimes is a challenge to navigate the balance between that. So you end up branching off and doing many other things. So I ended up, working in the built environment, and I studied urban planning and environmental management. But still, all these things have had their influence on my art perspective and how I shape my artistic creativity, incorporating all the experiences that I've had in the world. So I'm still on that path. I'm growing. I'm still producing more and more art. And my perspective of my identity is more of a creative person rather than just a visual artist. I think you reach a level where your creative identity becomes part of you rather than something you do, rather than an activity. So being an artist becomes being an artist rather than being a person who paints or, you know, does some artwork. So my expression of art goes even beyond painting and producing work on canvas. I also write, and even lately I've been playing around with the idea of motion picture, which is still the same idea, but migrating, not just dealing with stationary, flat visual images, but how you can incorporate other aspects of art, like sound, like motion, and, you know, how that has impact on people and on the world. Because the idea of what you're trying to do is looking for tools that can enable you to have as much impact on society as much as possible. Because the idea is how you can express your vision. And as an artist, you use different tools at your disposal. Also, so in a sense, you become a multidisciplinary or a multimedia artist in that journey and pursuit.
Right. Your camera's shaking a bit, so I don't know if it's on a table or desk that's moving a bit. So just be mindful of that. But thank you for sharing that. So you mentioned writing. So I thought that was fascinating. Like one of the for the people joining us today, I'm gonna give put this in a little bit of context, right? So I've only known you for less than 2 years, right? I mean, I think about speaking of time, right? One of the first things that I discovered about you is that you've written some books, or, you know, and that was, you know, that's always admirable, because I, you know, it's like, I'm one of those people that always like, yeah, one day I'm going to write a book. So can you talk a little bit about how your writing informs your visual art? If it does at all, can you, and also like, can you tell people like what you've written about?
Yeah. It's interesting because the connections are so dramatic and very inspiring in reality, because when I was much younger in school, I really did not visualize myself as a literary person. I always was a slow reader, and I thought, writing and reading, these are difficult things. And I'm not a fast reader. But however, when I was younger in my teens, I was so exposed to music, specifically reggae music. And I got interested in the movement of dub poetry. So I got hooked on poetry. So that was my first impulse to writing poetry to start with. So poetry evolved in, grew and grew and evolved into writing nonfiction material. And then eventually I wrote my first significant nonfiction book, which was Beyond the Talented 10th, and I think that comes relevant to this Black History Month, because it deals with the vision of W.E. Du Bois, of how he was talking about how we can transform Black America by elevating the talented 10th of the society. That if you focus on the talented 10th, a portion of the society that is special abilities or capacity or resources, they can lift everybody up and be able to elevate the whole community. So that is what my first book was dealing with, but it was really titled Beyond the Talented 10th. In other words, I was looking at that in the modern day era, everybody stands on the same platform and can contribute towards the empowerment of Black America. Then after that, I think I wrote a piece of fiction. Then more recently, a few years ago, I wrote a book called Deep Down the Rabbit Hole, Reality is Not What You Think. So, but how this plays out is all this writing is an investigation into meaning, identity, and reality. My constant thought form and pursuit is trying to understand, what does this all mean? What are we here to do? What's my role in society? What's our collective role? And what's how can we have impact on humanity and in the world? How can we improve the world? How can we change the world? So this is the same thing that I'm investigating in my visual arts. It's an investigation of what is this? How do we fit into reality? How are we part of nature? How do we transform society? And understanding how all this works. So there is this connection because I'm just using different tools to do the same investigation, just like one would do in a lab or in another platform. You're trying to understand the nature of reality, the nature of society and our role. So this is all connected because it's all investigative work using different creative materials.
And so would you say that your writing has had an impact on the visual art to the extent that you're exploring some of the concepts in your writing and your painting? Would that be accurate to say?
Yes and no. They're connected, but also independent. When I'm doing it in my painting, like lately, I'm not consciously trying to bring the topics that I dealt with in my writing, but somehow they coincide. I do it totally independent. I just go through painting just like any other painter. But it turns out that my mind gets preoccupied with the same subjects that I'm preoccupied with when I'm writing. Just for example, my latest painting deal a lot with boundaries, with borders, with edges, with space. I'm trying to look at spatial negotiations, and I realize that the idea of boundaries and space is an important subject in our lives, because when we talk about topics like immigration, topics like gentrification, just like the painting Amazon Gentrification deals with, is dealing with negotiation between the environment, the built environment, and natural environment. And then you have immigration coming into the center of the play, especially in modern politics. So these are societal issues as well as environmental issues that we are handling. So when I'm painting, I just go with it, you know, just like any other painter. But it turns out that the subjects emerge as points of relationships that I can also be connected and related to the literature. For instance, I recently wrote a screenplay that I hope in the future I can produce a movie from it. The topic is actually borderline, and it's dealing with immigration, which is the same topic of space and boundaries that I'm dealing with in the paintings. So it's the same topic, it's the same contain. I don't know why I'm preoccupied with issues like that, but I guess this is the case with many artists, that you just have things that keep, you know, propelling you to investigate them and explore them further and further.
I'm laughing because there've been these stretches of time where I'm like, oh, I haven't heard from Adin in a while. I wonder what he's up to. But from the sound of things, you're either writing a screenplay or you're writing a book, or you're like, I mean, it's like
all over the place.
I don't know where you find the time. I mean, people say that to me sometimes, but it's like, yeah. Anyway, that's fantastic. In your bio, I mentioned that you use coffee or coffee residue in some of your paintings, and perhaps recently, all of your recent paintings. Can you talk a little bit about that? And then obviously we're going to have an opportunity to look at some work behind you, of course. We're going to have an opportunity to look more closely at some of your work. But can you talk about what brought you to using coffee as a medium?
Well, that just evolved as an accident. I think originally I just spilled coffee on a table drinking coffee, and the stain impressed me. I was like, oh, look at that. The whole configuration of how a spill configures itself in a specific manner on a platform or on a piece of cloth, that impressed me. So, and also it just happened to me that I was brewing a lot of coffee and just throwing away the residue, so much of it in the garbage bin every day. Then I thought, wow, why don't I put two and two together and transform this into artwork? So what I did, I started taking all coffee residue and then brewing it. And after brewing it, I stretched the canvas. Many times when I'm painting, I actually stretch my canvas because I like that process of the beginning, the evolution of the artwork through the spread of paint or gesso on an explored canvas. When I'm doing that, I get a sense of direction and image of where I should take the painting at that stage. Whereas if I get an already stretched canvas, the feeling is not the same. You know, I don't feel like I'm part of it from the beginning. So what I normally do after stretching the canvas, I put gesso, before it dries, I drop the coffee residue at sporadic parts of the canvas and let it sit into the canvas. So as it sits, it starts to spread and it distributes itself in a very spontaneous, accidental, and at the same time, controlled manner. So I combine what just happens spontaneously versus the control. Then what emerges is always a pictographical image that gives me a sense of what it is. And a majority of times they appear to be aerial views of geographical aerial views, like how you'd look at the landscape if you look at it from above. And many times it also mirrors how the sky looks at night, the bodies of the sky, how they configure themselves with the clouds and the planets and everything like that. So it is very interesting, but it really prompted me to think deeply in terms of, because when I started this, I thought it was about the coffee and the coffee residue, but I actually realized that it was about the liquid, it was about the water. And something funny actually happened one day because I was painting and I was thinking, it looks like everything has been done. It looks like in this art world today, everything has been explored, because at the time I was playing around with geometrical abstraction and the hard edge. I was really fascinated with artists like Frank Stella and all that. And I was trying to see how I can replicate or do work in that vein. But I was thinking, but this is explored fully. I mean, how can I make a contribution in this arena that has been fully dealt with? Then it just happened to me, I got an idea that, the answer is in liquid. The answer is water. But then I started using coffee. I didn't really make the connection, but as I used it more and more, it liquefied further and further and became more fluid to the level where I was eventually using tints. Then I realized that, I was really dealing with the medium of liquid and its nature.
Right. So we've talked a lot about your work. So we're gonna go. We have a slideshow of several images. We're gonna play that now, and then we can spend a little bit of time on each work and talk through. So now that people have heard about it, now we're gonna show them, right? So let's cue that up. So for each of these works, if we're gonna spend a minute or so, just talking about title, medium, scale, inspiration, that would be helpful.
So this painting is one of the really first ones that I did with the coffee residue pour. As you can see, it really looks splashed.
Is there music?
It looks very liquid. You can see the tint sipping through.
Is there music in your background, Adin?
All right,
no problem. You know, with the way the world is now and everybody working from home and doing all this, we just got to roll with it. That's my view. I was just commenting to Adin before we got started here today that if this was taking place 1 hour early, I'd be the one with kids in the background making a bunch of noise. So we're going to be patient. All right, let's go.
Sorry about that. In fact, what happened is that my daughter figured out it was a good idea to come with a, you know, with a tablet and play it in front of me.
Of course.
Yeah. So, but if you look at this painting, you see something interesting with the edges. The edges, they resemble the geographical configuration of coastlines, you know? So it looks like a landmass. And of course, the edges is also defined by the nature of how water shapes land. So this is actually a landscape painting, even though it's, in a sense, abstraction, and it doesn't resemble the normal way we look at landscape paintings. So the size is probably 6 by 6 feet, almost.
Oh, fantastic. We can advance to the next work.
Yeah, this one is Amazon gentrification. What is dealing with, and by the way, this is the painting currently being shown at the Harvey Gantt Center. So what you see here is again the landscape, the landmass, trees, water bodies, a coastal edge, but at the same time, you see the intrusion of the built environment interfering with the natural environment. You see these hard edge geometrical shapes representing man-made object construction, land being interrupted by roads, by highways, and this kind of thing. So this is looking at what's happening with the Amazon's destruction and the impact of human presence and their interaction with that natural environment. And of course, this just goes beyond the Amazon. It's happening everywhere. So it brings us to thoughts on how we can balance the built environment and the natural environment.
And I have a question. Why is that so important to you?
Good question. Good question. And it's that's interesting, difficult question, because if you look at it, I have that background with planning, with the built environment. So probably in a sense, these topics always preoccupy my mind. But maybe there is also a sense of dealing with the idea of location, belonging and identity, being probably being an immigrant also has an impact on how I view the issues of space, location, and identity. And at the same time, I'm generally concerned with the future of the planet. You know, what's happening with the environment? I think these are concerns that one has to take seriously, because it's not something that's just going to go away naturally. It's something that we have to address. And I think the role of an artist is also partially, besides just expressing creativity and color and beauty, also to deal with the hard questions that are in some sense contentious. So I think maybe this is one topic that's contentious, because as you see, there's so many arguments about the environment, destruction of the environment, the planet, pollution, and all this, and there's so much back and forth, but nevertheless, it's a topic that has to be dealt with.
That's great. Thank you for sharing that. Let's advance to the next.
Yeah, this, in the same vein, it's also a painting dealing with landmass. It's an aerial view of a piece of land, and the color spectrums sort of brings the idea of the riches of the land and the allocations, distribution, and variety. And I think this was inspired by an old volcano or volcanic event that happened somewhere in the is it the Middle East? somewhere there in the old world. But this is really dealing with that. It's dealing with just land mass, land distribution, and how geography is shaped by different elements, by water, by vegetation, by rocks, by mountains, as well as the human presence.
Yeah, one of the things that you mentioned earlier that I really do feel when I'm looking at your work is that there's this combination of happenstance and sort of randomness, but also, you know, I think we might see in works that sort of after this, you can kind of clearly see that there's also a plan. So it's a combination of the two. And then why don't we advance to the next? And so maybe it might,
Before we go talking about style, one might realize that there is a little bit of Clifford Steele, the artist. Yeah, Clifford Steele. If you remember his artist, his work, he seemed to be dealing with defining the jagged edges. That also seems to come about, but I didn't do that consciously. In fact, when I started doing these paintings, I didn't even really pay attention to his old works. But later I realized, oh, somebody else has some elements that are similar. He's dealing with that squiggly line, the rugged edge, and the sharp contrast of different colors colliding together. Although his works are more, the variations are less because it's almost like a magnification of specific area then enhancing that rather than having these different elements distributed all over the painting. This painting, it's interesting because I remember talking to you about this painting, Dex, and I say that this reminds me of the event that happened after 9/11 when George Bush said, oh, now we're declaring war on Iraq. He called it shock and awe, you know? And I thought, oh, this looks like how it appeared on TV the night of the invasion when the bombs and the explosives were exploding and, you know, all over the city and all you could see were blowing lights like fireworks. So this also reminds me of that setup where you see almost explosions. And at the same time, it prompts me to think about the birth of stars and planetary bodies, you know? Such processes are so violent, so vibrant, so colorful. So in a sense, I was exploring that rebirth, which I suspect also happens at cellular level. I think when you have specific processes happening at a cellular level, they resemble things that happen at global as well as galactic level on the ground as well as in the sky.
Wow, yeah. And I do remember us having that conversation. And you know, every time I come back to this piece, I'm reminded of that. There's so much like subtlety in the work as well. I'm also curious about your use of color. I mean, obviously every painter who uses color will have their own rationale, but is there something you can share about your color choices?
Yeah, somebody, I remember one friend many years ago, he said, he looked at my painting and said, oh, you have these, you use these African colors so distinctive. I thought, what? I thought colors were just colors. But what he was talking about is the usage of a lot of primary colors like blue and red as raw colors. Even though this painting shows a lot of variation and color evolution, but most of the paintings, you see a significant use of color. Red is very predominant, and blue and yellow are the predominant colors. I'm wondering if subconsciously I've been sort of dealing with Mondrian reality of trying to see which colors have the most impact. So some of it is not conscious. Of course, I have a preference. I have a preference for red, blue, and yellow. But I think some of it is not conscious. It's just colors that seem to fit the layout and the configuration of what you're doing on the canvas, you know, although there's a specific consistency pattern that seems to appear on most paint.
Let's advance to the next work. So this is unique.
Yeah, this is very interesting. This is a very recent, I think maybe 2 weeks ago or so. It's actually a very big painting. I don't know, maybe 9 foot by 7 or something, or 8 by 11. But how this evolves now, it's the process actually informs the appearance of the painting. What I'm doing with these paintings now, they sort of have the sense of the color spectrum that you see in the DC color class of DC color field class. The work, for instance, if you look at the work of Sam Gillian, you see a lot of resemblance on how he handles color on material, or how he distributes it, or in a sense tints the material, you know. So somehow I ended up stumbling upon this process where I pour one color on the, or paint on the canvas. Then whilst it's still soaked, before it dries, I roll the canvas over itself. Rather than wait for it to dry, I just roll it. So after I roll it, I put it on somewhere. So the paint sips into the canvas and spreads and distributes and mix all by itself. Or in a sense, sometimes what I do is I create one painting, put paint on it, before it dries, I take another painting, raw paint, and lay it flat over the new painting so that the paint spreads or distributes on two paintings at the same time. So the interaction creates a very interesting layout and configuration of paint. So this is exactly how it evolved. But what happened after I finished doing this painting, my daughter came and she wanted to take a picture in front of the painting. But then I realized, oh, the way she's dressing resembles something with the color spectrum that is on the painting. For instance, if you look at her hair, the blue hair resembles the blue in the background. The skirt has these stripes of yellow, red, blue, and green, which totally matches the painting. So in a sense, she became part of the painting rather than somebody standing in front of the painting. She became part and parcel of the painting. But that's an interesting painting, and that's a new evolution of how the method has been evolving lately.
I think we may have one or two more. Let's see. Let's advance. I don't think that. I didn't think that was the last one. Correct.
This one is called Land of Milk and Honey. I think it's 6 by 7. Again, it's dealing with geographical layouts and landscape. And this one can more clearly see. It's almost like a NASA picture, you know, like how you see if you're on one of those Hubble satellites up above and looking down on the planet Earth, you know, how you see the water, how you see the oceans, and the interaction with land. And it's such a fluid, rich painting, and you can see the actual flow of paint. What I did was I did a lot of pouring in this paint, and I used a lot of liquid. Then I let it settle, moved it all around, see how it was playing, like you say, the interaction between happenstance and control. And this is exactly what brought about this painting. And by the way, it was one of the paintings exhibited at Soko Gallery.
Yeah, and I think we may have an install image from that show in this slideshow. Let's see, which image is next?
This is actually a very different painting
from the works that we've seen before. I mean, there are angles and hard edges in this painting that we haven't seen in the previous works.
Yeah, this one again is utilizing a different method. And as you can see, it's very has a lot of open space. It's very empty. It's not super saturated like the previous painting, and it has a lot of hard straight edges. But what's interesting besides that is the process, how it was done. It's actually a negative, because what I did was I actually made the painting on the other side, then rolled it. Then after it dried, I saw that the back side looked better than the front side. But it looked so sketchy and scanty and, you know, not fully saturated. So what I did was I took the painted areas as the positive space and started painting, back painting in the negative space. So what you see, all this blue, the straight edge, is actually paint being negotiated around the previously saturated spots, so that I'm filling in the negative space with paint. And it's interesting investigation of space, like investigating what is foreground, what is background, you know? It's almost like the idea of how we explain visibility of light, like when other colors actually absorbed and one color is reflected. It's almost like that concept of back and forth, that what you see may actually be the absence of everything else, you know? So again, in a sense, it's also dealing with negotiation and distribution of space. You have the what's scattered that resembles a landscape, what looks grayish, you know, it looks like a background, it resembles landscape. And then you have the straight edges that resemble the built environment. Again, they look like highways, you know, they look like, in a sense, if you actually rotate it 90 degrees, some of them look like sun rays of the sun in the horizon. Mm-hmm. So there are many ways you can view this, and, you know, but I find the process interesting, although the process is actually very slow and kind of tedious, but I actually like the results, you know?
I think it's great. Let's advance to the next. And again, This has an element that's quite different from even the previous work. I mean, now we're starting to see structures.
Yeah. It's evolving into something else. It's almost like it took the previous painting, then added something, and it looks more richer. But the subject matter, the title of this painting is called Favela Dreams. It's dealing with the built environment in Brazil. I think probably you know, or everybody, many people know, the neighborhoods that they call favelas in Brazil. They are sort of what one would think of in terms of high density urban ghetto, you know, pretty much, because you have buildings laid on top of buildings, behind buildings, in front of buildings. And some of the neighborhoods are quite actually notorious for crime and many problems. But actually, on the other hand, it shows, if you look at the evolution of how they ended up creating such an environment, you see the innovation of people utilizing whatever they had to create neighborhoods, and utilizing whatever space they have to create neighborhoods and communities and build viable environments based on that. So we see a lot of innovation, a lot of resilience in terms of the populations living in those neighborhoods, you know, how people live their lives fully and raise their families and actually have dreams and pursue their dreams, you know, in such environments. So despite the bad reputation of the neighborhoods, there's actually something good that one can see in those favelas of people utilizing fully what they have in order to sustain their livelihood. So this Favela Dreams painting is an investigation into that idea of space sharing and space distribution within that environment. Again, the same topic.
Well, I mean, clearly where you live now in Harlem is very different than Brazil. But I want to just take a moment. I want to take a little moment to talk about the neighborhood that you're in. I mean, you know, I'm originally from New York City, so I'm very familiar with Harlem. But maybe just for like a moment, can you just, for folks who've never been to Harlem or never even been to New York for that matter, talk a little bit about your neighborhood. I mean, it's such a rich history there. I don't know how long you've lived in Harlem, but if you could just kind of share a little bit about where you live, that'd be great.
Oh, I've lived in Harlem for over a decade, for a long time now. And it's such a, it's a diverse, although historically, you know, it's a Black community, but it's actually diverse. Actually, when you go towards the West Side, it's more Spanish, they call it Spanish Harlem, you know. Then you have the Central Harlem, which is actually historically notorious because remember in the 60s, the time of the drugs, the 70s and 60s, times of drugs and violence and all that. But at the same time, in terms of the civil rights history, it's very rich, as well as creativity and literature and art. You have Malcolm X really being associated with Harlem, you know. You have Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey had his headquarters right on, I think, 127, you know. I mean, I've been to the place, you know. So Harlem has that rich history in terms of especially the civil rights and Black liberation movement, as well as literature and artistic expression. But over the years, it has continued to evolve and change. And right now, what you're seeing, if you visit Harlem, many people get surprised because they expect to see the Harlem of the 70s or 80s or 60s. But when they visit, they're surprised because it's a totally different place. Again, of course, there's the issue of gentrification that's happening. I mean, on my street, in my neighborhood, I've seen so much change in terms of demographics, which in itself is not a problem. However, people always bring this point like, we would rather have development without replacement. Development doesn't have to mean displacement of a specific population. It should just happen and, you know, people develop, the neighborhoods develop, they become more viable, they become more richer without exactly replacing population. But majority of times populations are replaced and different populations with better income come in, and then it becomes safer, it becomes better. So there's that whole contradiction that's happening too. But very close to where I live, you have the Shamrock Center, you have the Harlem Studio Museum, you have many facilities, you have many historical places that, you know, actually I live right close to Adam Clayton Powell and Malcolm X on the other side. So that on its own, in the names, it carries and resembles and sustains the history that where it's coming from. So, but it's culturally very rich, you know, amazing place to live, you know. So I hope everybody has an opportunity to visit, yeah. Have a pilgrim visit Harlem.
well, nostalgia is a crazy thing. Let's advance to the next image while I say this. I mean, you know, I'm originally from Brooklyn, and you know, it's kind of like the same thing where you go through these periods of time where there's change that happens in the neighborhood. But neighborhoods in New York have always changed. They've always, you know, gone through certain degrees of change. It's just been accelerated by the disparity of income. I think, and also some, you know, other factors that we certainly don't have time to get into right now. let's talk about the final couple of images in the slideshow. Then we have a little special treat for people to show, like, your space where you actually make your work. So let's quickly go through this and any other images we have in the slideshow before we run out of time.
All right. Yeah, this is called the eucalyptus. Again, you can clearly see that it resembles the eucalyptus trees dealing with nature. I've been fascinated with the eucalyptus color richness since I was young, and I'm always fascinated by Australian landscape. So here I, you know, decided to capture that in a painting. I think this is like, again, probably 7 by 6 feet. And it's actually a recent painting from a few months ago. But yeah, it's interesting too. Yeah.
And you've been working really large. What's the, I guess
what's the impetus?
Why? Why so large?
It's funny, you know, despite being in a very limited space in terms of working space, I actually find myself going very large. I don't know what's happening, but I think it's the freedom that I find when I'm just, you know, working on a big space, a large canvas. There is the freedom of expression. And also it almost gives room for you to be inside the painting when you're doing the painting. So I like that, being inside the painting when you're painting, you know. So it's been happening, you know. It's not so deliberate, but it has been happening gradually that I find my paintings going bigger and bigger.
I get it.
Yep.
Let's advance to the next.
It's probably the last, I guess.
Is it the next? Well, we have a question come in. Can you expand a little bit on the connection between your written work and your artwork? Did you study physics or some other science?
No, but I'm interested in the relationship between, I think, in a sense, maybe many artists do not clearly explain or articulate it. There is always an investigative role of one's art style. It's almost like every time you're painting or doing something, you're trying to figure that something out. So in a sense, that almost like a scientific endeavor, you know? So the writing, the subjects that I'm exploring, as I said before, they're also investigative, but I actually don't have any background in science, although I like specifically quantum physics because of its fluidity and its ability to touch realms that are non-physical, because there's a very spiritual aspect or side of art that, you know, hard science does not want to deal with. But I can tell you that many artists, when they are painting, because you go into a trance, your mind opens specific paths and channels, and you get all sorts of ideas and even visions, you know? So it's almost like a psychedelic experience when you're painting, because you're in a trance, you're meditating. And when you're meditating, things happen, you know? You might hear things, yeah. You might see things.
Yeah. I could dig it. So I mentioned we have something special. So let's end the slideshow and we can queue up a video. We have a very, very, very brief video to show your space. I mean, normally with the open air talks, what we do is we'll ask the participating artists to turn their camera onto their space and walk us through. But you did us the great favor of creating a short little clip that we can play. So we want to queue that up. But in the meantime, can you answer this question? Do you frame your work or do you drape the unstretched canvases? Maybe you can answer that before we play the video.
I do both, you know, because sometimes there are people who prefer to have framed work. But if there is somebody who prefers loose work that you can, you know, just hang, you know, with a pin or just throw like a, you know, like a bed cover, that's also good. But a majority of the paintings before they are sold or delivered to a collector or something, they are actually mounted on a frame and, you know, delivered.
Great. Well, let's play this video. I'm not hearing the audio on this. Are you?
No.
Well, while this is planned, it's only about a minute long. Maybe we can also chat a little bit. So talk about living with your work, right? So clearly, when you talk about live workspace, what is it like to make work in this environment, in the sense that it seems like you're surrounded by your work? What are the pros and cons?
The pros is, because I'm doing like as you see, it's actually home studio. The advantage of that is the efficiency of time. Any time of the day or the night, I can just get painting. You know, many times I actually paint very late at night. You know, so I can utilize the little bit of time that I have here and there to paint. So in the end, I can do a lot because I'm not spending time traveling or going somewhere else to produce the way I do it right where I am. You know, I can even, just stretch it on the bed or something and then paint. So that's the benefit. However, the downside is because it's a shared space, like I said before, you're trying to paint, then the kid comes and steps all over the painting, So that's a challenge in terms of focus. You can get interrupted, but I normally deal with that by painting late in the night or late in the evening. That's usually how I get around that. But living with the paintings is quite interesting because it's inspiring. It gives you a sense of where you've been, where you're going, and what you're addressing and what you're dealing with. And it's actually inspiring, to see the works around you, although it can become a challenge in terms of storage if the place becomes super saturated. So yeah, like you say, they're both sides of the coin, there's a benefit and a challenge, but you learn to do your best with what you have.
Well, I mean, I think that's a good note to probably start winding down our conversation, like doing the best of what you have. Tell me, like most artists, I'm sure you have plans, things you're thinking about doing. Like, what are you looking forward to? What's next on your agenda in terms of the kind of work that you'd like to make? I mean, is there anything that you could share?
Yes, I'm thinking more in terms of how I can be able to become more active in terms of community involvement. In other words, in the past 2 years, the whole thing with COVID and everything has brought a lot of isolation, and I wanna see more participation in terms of myself and networking with other artists, with community groups, even, there's something as simple as going to school and doing a painting in front of school, that's something beautiful that can inspire the kids, it's something that has cultural value in itself. So I want to become more involved in working with institutions and museums and producing more works. And so, yeah, I want to produce better, bigger works, and be able to reach out to a greater audience and have more platforms, especially in terms of discussing more serious issues on how community can be improved through meaning, through dialogue, through artwork, through working together. I'm inspired. Things are coming.
No, I think you would be a fantastic teacher. I mean, something tells me.
I hope so.
I don't know if you have any experience in that space, but it just seems to me like the way that you have connected your literary work with your visual art, and then these other things that you've expressed your interest in. I mean, just something tells me that you would really have a lot to share, not just to young people, but people your own age. perhaps even older. So Adin, you know, I want to thank you for welcoming us into your space today. I don't take it for granted. I know that, you know, although our conversation today is only about an hour, there's a lot of prep that goes into these things. And I like to remind people of that, that it's not just what you see, it's all of the stuff that happens behind the scenes. And so we really do appreciate that. And I'm looking forward to seeing you the next time I'm in New York. I'm certain that everyone at the Harvey B. Gantt Center would be happy to see you in Charlotte if you find yourself down.
Absolutely, I would love to do that.
you know, again, thank you for today. I'm going to just say some closing words here, and you can sign off. And again, I look forward to seeing you soon. I want to thank everyone for joining us for this month's open air. It was a pleasure discussing the journeys of, you know, this incredible artist. And the Gantt Center's goal is to provide programs that inform and inspire. The support of viewers like you allows the Gantt Center to expand its reach and further develop programs like Open Air. To learn more about the ways you can support the Gantt Center, please visit their website, gantcenter.org/donate. Also, be sure to click the subscribe button below the screen to be updated on future virtual programs. We look forward to connecting with you again for next month's Open Air featuring artist Brittany Leanne Williams. I want to thank you all and have a great night.
Thank you.
Thank you.